another celebration with Fallingbrook Heights Baptist Church at the Center. We encourage you to prepare your heart, mind, and soul for a time of reflection, learning, and prayer. If you have any questions, or if you're just looking to chat, check out our website, churchatthecenter.com. And now, let's worship.
Welcome to
church.
Welcome to church.
Welcome to church.
Welcome to church.
Oh yes, you are welcome to participate in church. Welcome to church life. And as we gather together today, you're welcome to participate in the supernatural and natural expressions of church life. Sing joyfully, pray with intent, reflect on God's word as we speak about it. Welcome to church, and throughout the week, as we gather together Sundays, and as we connect on Wednesdays for prayer and meetings from face to face, you can be part of the life of our church. Welcome to church. Today we'll be celebrating communion at the end of our service, so we welcome you to prepare the elements as you're able.
The chasm that lay between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross has spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. Sealed the promise, your buried body. the silence, the roaring lion, declare the grave has no claim on me. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. You have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never.
Hi Church, it's Patricia, back with the results of our May fundraising initiative, and I'm thrilled to report that we exceeded our goal of raising $2,600. These funds will be used to bring much needed relief to families and children in Mexico who are living in poverty and who are greatly impacted by this pandemic. So a big thank you for all of you who were able to contribute financially. Our church also provided sponsorship to three children from a cluster of families just north of Mexico City, but there are still many more children who need sponsorship. So we're going to leave the site up until the end of June to give an opportunity for those of you who would still like to contribute financially or sponsor a child. And of course, your ongoing prayer support for the work of Compassion Canada in Mexico is equally, if not more, important. Thank you and God bless.
Good morning, church family. I'm here to make an announcement about Go Into Camp. Go Into is a week-long camp for youth ages 11 through 18. This year, camp will be held from July 5th through the 9th. Typically, camp involves day trips to various sites around the city, community building, leadership skills, and of course, growth through God. We have been in discussion and planning phase of camp for the past couple of months, and we are excited to say that we are very hopeful to be able to have camp this year. Obviously, we are awaiting the decision from Toronto Public Health on what camp can and will look like this year, but trust that we are planning as if camp is a go. If you are a youth interested in camp, please connect with myself or Pastor Ken to let us know. If you are a church member who would like to support our camp either through leadership, financial, or prayer support, please connect with Pastor Ken or myself. We look forward to an exciting week.
Are you training? Are you ready? Stay tuned June 20th for Kids Zone Service, a special service for the young and the young at heart. Be there as we race to victory. Are you ready?
Sing with me if you know the song. Sunny day, sweeping the clouds away, on my way to where the air is sweet. Can you tell me how to get to Sesame Street? Come and play, everything's A-okay. Friendly neighbors there, that's where we meet. Can you tell me how to get to Sesame Street? If you watch the original program of Sesame Street, there was Big Bird and Elmo and Oscar the Grouch. There was Grover and Cookie Monster and Ernie and Bert, but I can't see them here at Sesame Street, Toronto. If you watch the program or watch the program over the years, the original 123 Sesame Street was an apartment building with steps out front where the gang would meet. It was a frequent gathering place, and down the street was Mr. Hooper's store and the fix-it shop, the open courtyard area and the arbor, the old carriage house and the house and garage decorated with letters and tire swings and benches. Oscar the Grouch lived in the trash can just on the street. There was a pile of crates. A line of salvaged doors led to Big Bird's Nest, Mr. McIntosh's fruit stand, Willie's hot dog stand next by. Toronto's Sesame Street is perhaps not as diverse as 123 Sesame Street, the program, but it's an actual community like yours and like mine. We're going to think about community. Think about how this works together, how we live together, what it means to love one another. So let's go to a place in our Birchcliff community. Let's go to a place called The Reach. Join me there at The Reach. Well, welcome to The Reach. Today we begin our second series in our annual theme for the year, Deep Faith and Healthy Pursuits. In the month of February, we considered our first step, the step of discipleship. And you can go back and review those videos. Today, we move into interaction and encouraging in the pursuit of true fellowship in community under Jesus' call and banner, love one another. So, with Sesame Street as a fun backdrop to community, an expression of community, we're going to consider the Apostle Paul's stop on his second and third missionary journey in one city, Philippi. This was between the years 50 and 54 AD in the area of Asia Minor. Traveling through Asia Minor, he moved across the north part of the Aegean Sea into Macedonia. Macedonia was where Philippi was. We're going to consider in this series the city of Philippi, and then if we have the time, we're going to look at the community of Philadelphia in the ancient world. But first, Philippi. Philippi was a major Greek city northwest of the nearby island of Thasos. Thasos was significant because it was Thasian colonists that established the city of Philippi. Philippi is north of the Aegean Sea. It was self-named just a couple of years later by King Philip of Macedon, 356 BC. It was established as a community by King Philip because of its gold and silver mines that were nearby, its natural springs. And Philip II built important fortifications and a theater. He drained the nearby swamp and he established a mint there. This mint in its height produced 1,000 talents of gold in a year. 1,000 talents of gold, to put it in today's perspective, is an income of over $1.5 billion. And this certainly helped Philip's son, Alexander, become the great. Fast forward a couple hundred years, in the first century BC, it was Mark Antony and Octavian that confronted the forces of Julius Caesar's assassins, Marcus Brutus and Gaius Cassius, at the Battle of Philippi, just west of the city. October 42 BC. Antony and Octavian won this final battle against the partisans of the Republic, and veteran soldiers from that battle recolonized the city of Philippi. The city was built then into a miniature Rome. It had a privileged position on the Via Egnatia. Many monuments there today give evidence to its expanding influence, its wealth at the time of Paul. There's a theater enlarged there that held the Roman games. Roman successors made this leading city a Roman colony by Paul's time. And so we look in the book of Acts. In Acts 12, we see this experience that Paul had, this travel that Paul had as he traveled through the area. Let me just summarize for you. Acts 16:12 says, from Neapolis, this is Luke and Timothy and Paul and the rest of those who traveled with him, traveled to Philippi, a Roman colony, a leading city. And they shared the good news of Jesus Christ in that city. There was one person in particular who responded, and that was Lydia, a seller of purple. And spiritual warfare arose in that city. Paul and Silas were arrested. They were stripped. They were beaten with rods. And after they were thrown into prison and were singing songs at midnight, an earthquake erupted. And God rescued those that were in the prison through this violent earthquake. It loosened their chains, the doors of the prison, and the Philippian jailer accepted the Lord when he saw his power. 3 months later, Paul and Silas, Timothy and Luke left Philippi to Amphipolis and Apollonia and Thessalonica, heading westward. 3 years later, they returned again on the third missionary journey. Paul stopped in Philippi briefly. And 7 years later, about 62 AD, as a resident of one of Rome's finest prisons, Paul wrote a letter to Philippi. He and Timothy wrote this letter. And it starts off this way. To all God's holy people in Christ Jesus at Philippi, together with the overseers and deacons. As we continue to read this passage, let God deepen your faith and encourage healthy pursuits in your life. Deacon Pat will be leading us.
Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God every time I remember you. In all my prayers for all of you, I always pray with joy because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now, being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. Philippians 1, verses 2 to 6.
Paul, from prison, gives ways to deepen your faith in these five verses. Number one, receive the grace and the peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Accept it. Number two, thank God when you remember his love, when you remember his community. Number three, pray with joy, or keep praying until you enjoy it. Number four, partner in the gospel, just as Paul writes to the Philippians. And know this deep truth, the Holy Spirit has begun a good work in you and will carry it on to completion until the day when Jesus Christ returns. Paul is already deep into his letter to the Philippians with this introduction, but he gets even deeper.
I long for all of you with the affection of Christ Jesus, and this is my prayer, that your love may abound more and more in knowledge and depth of insight, so that you may be able to discern what is best, and may be pure and blameless for the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ, to the glory and praise of God. Philippians 1, verses 8 to 11.
Paul from prison longs for, he prays for this community of faith, and he prays the very things that we want, timeless essences that we need in life. Number one, he prays and we seek that love, our love, would grow deeper in knowledge and in insight. Number two, Paul longs for and we desire to discern what is best, especially during these challenging times we live. Number three, Paul prays and we desire to be pure, blameless, fruitful through Jesus and for Jesus before he returns. Just with this brief introduction of the letter that Paul's writing to the Philippians, we can ask ourselves this question. So what does the Sesame Street crew, what does Paul and John, who would later write to Philadelphia, what do the Philippian believers, what does your church, what do you and I have in common in this community building that we pursue? Well, here's the truth. You and I have an author, a creator. He seeks that we grow in wisdom and stature and favor with him. That's his desire. His plan is for us to grow, to ultimately commune with him. The truth is, communion produces community. In communion, we are united in Christ beyond what we can even imagine. So as we begin this journey of pursuing deep faith and healthy pursuits, interacting, encouraging, pursuing true fellowship, we start with communion, which we'll celebrate in just a moment or two. Even though we're apart, we'll celebrate this timeless truth of community. But before we do that, let me challenge you this way. This week, as you go out and live your life and do the things that you need to do and God calls you to do, I encourage you to interact in fellowship, to encourage others, to call someone, text someone, Zoom, to write a letter, and to do that with three someones. I encourage you to call or text or pray or connect with or Zoom someone in your church life. I encourage you to connect in some way to your extended community. I know that you'll connect with your family, those closest to you. That, as Jesus said, that's just being a human being. But connect with someone who's in your extended community. And number three, connect with someone who's brand new to you, who you don't even know yet. And if you hear these words and you say, I'm just too shy, I'm too much of an introvert to do so, then pray for these people. Commune with God and take their names, take who they are before God and pray for them. Let's take a moment. Prepare ourselves as we enter into communion. Communion is an incredible sacrament. It's an incredible privilege. It's an incredible opportunity for us to gather together spiritually. Together, 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 though apart. The ancient Israelites had Passover once a year in which they celebrated the freedom and the rescue of God. This is what Jesus was celebrating when he gathered his disciples together. In a couple moments, our deacons are going to pray for us. But before they do so, let me just remind you of what Paul wrote to the Corinthians. 1 Corinthians chapter 11. He gives them directions on the Lord's Supper, as it's also called. The Lord's Supper, truly, communion, the Eucharist, is not owned by any church or denomination. It's the Lord's Supper. It's been celebrated ever since he originally celebrated it. Paul extends these words, but before I read them, Paul writes that we would do it in a worthy manner. What it means is to pause and say, God, I'm fully transparent before you, authentic before you. Forgive me my sins, my trespasses, as I forgive others who have sinned or trespassed against me. It's a moment for reflection. You can ask the Holy Spirit to inform you of things that you need to pray about with him. Paul writes that we come before each other and before God and with each other, I should say, in a worthy manner. He writes in 1 Corinthians 11, "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you." The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." It tells us in the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." And then Paul adds this incredible statement, "For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." If you want to reflect on those verses, you can look at 1 Corinthians 11. Take a moment, prepare your heart, and our deacons are going to lead us as we pray for the bread and for the cup.
Good morning, church. Let's give thanks for the bread. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for today. Thank you for this chance to come together and to celebrate your love for us. Thank you, Lord, for giving your body to be broken for us. Even though right now we're living in uncertain times, Lord, we know because of the sacrifice you made, we don't have anything to fear. Lord, we pray that you would take our disappointments, our loss, our loneliness, and our feelings of being overwhelmed, and use those to draw us closer to you. When we eat this bread, we are reminded that you've already done everything for us. And so we are waiting with excited anticipation of how you will work in our lives for good. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Let's eat the bread together.
Heavenly Father, we thank you as we take this cup. We thank you for sending Jesus. We bless you, Lord Jesus, because of your blood, our sins are forgiven and we are released from our guilt. As we take this cup this morning, we bless you, Heavenly Father, for sending Jesus. We bless you, Jesus, for dying so that we might live. And we bless you, Holy Spirit, for making our lives look more and more like Jesus as we follow after him. So, Lord God, we thank you, we praise you, we worship you, and we take this cup in remembrance of what you have done for us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Well, here we are back on the street at Sesame Street. Huffington Post Entertainment on December 6th, 2017, Bill Bradley wrote an article, "Here's how you get to the real Sesame Street." Huffington Post Entertainment gathered Sesame Street clues all together and narrowed down the most likely whereabouts and reviewed the information with the show's executive producer, Carolyn Parente, to get her take on if Sesame Street could possibly be in one of these locations. After reviewing all the evidence, considering five places in New York City, in a detailed search, Huffington Post finally asked Parente, "Can you tell me how to get to Sesame Street?" Parente's response, "With a lot of hard work and good intentions, that's how you get to Sesame Street." So there you have it, kids. The article closes. You finally know. Sesame Street is a community. It's a fictitious community, of course, but you live in a community and so do I. And living in this community, we know that we need God to supply our needs, God to complete His work in us. So let me close with this benediction from the letter to Philippi. May God meet all your needs according to the riches of His glory in Christ Jesus. To the God and Father be glory forever and ever. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. Amen.
Thank you for joining us for this service. For more information, visit our website, churchatthecenter.com. God bless.